album concept hour. It's the album concept hour.
Welcome, everybody, to the Album Concept Hour. I am your host, Brad LeBaron, as I always am. And we have a doozy for you guys tonight. But first, we have our co-host, John. You heard his voice over there. What's going on, John?
Yeah, I'm doing good.
How you doing, Dave? What's going on, Dave?
Not too bad. Just chilling
over there.
Just a chill.
But it's not going to be, we're not going to be chilling for long with the album that we're doing. This is anything but chill. It is King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizards, Petrodragonic Apocalypse, or Dawn of Eternal Night, an Annihilation of Planet Earth, and the Beginning of Eternal Damnation. And we have Johnny from Niche Music Memes on the podcast. Welcome, Johnny. welcome to the podcast.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah. So we got a big album and a big guest. He's got some big memes. And he's someone that I followed your Instagram. I don't know, like Instagram, that the algorithm knew that I needed your memes. So the algorithm connected us.
There are some pretty good memes.
Thank you.
And I always find myself making my own little niche music memes. Like when I found your page, I'm like, I'm just going to start sending them to his DMs. So yeah. I sent you a few of my weird random music memes just because I needed someone to see them. So
people send me stuff and I'm just, and sometimes like this morning I got a meme idea and I'm like, that's funny. I'm going to make that. And I credited them. But some people send me stuff unprompted and I'm like, okay. And
thank you.
Good try. Now I know. Yeah, you sent me the Teenage Mutant Ninja Bowie. It's like so weird. Bow Wow. Bow Teriyaki Chicken. Yeah.
That one I knew was a very, like, there was not a lot of people that are going to upvote this one. I couldn't get it out of my head every time I passed that in the grocery aisle.
Yeah.
So inspiration
comes from anything. So
yeah. So right. You almost get the Weird Al treatment where people are like, hey, this is a good idea for a music meme.
I can't remember who, but a while ago, because I have personal Instagram and I like to only follow other music meme accounts.
Okay.
To just
nice.
Be in the community and see what everybody's doing and be inspired. And
scope,
I can't remember who it was.
So
someone openly openly was like, hey, what should I meme? And I would like to do that, like to get like a bunch of submissions, just because that'd be a nice change of pace.
Some people will
I don't know if they make them or, and I'm not dissing these people, it's just unexpected. This is the biggest following of anything I've had, so it's just interesting. But what's cool is, as on, you know, that's kind of a boring conversation, is the cool thing I like to brag about and like what's fulfilling is I'll meme an artist, like I'll meme a band.
Yeah.
That artist will comment or share or
that's really cool.
That's next level, because they saw it and they like it. And like, and it's not like, as in like, cause you're kind of scared. What if they see this? But like, oh, what if they see this? And for them to share it is win-win. Cause that's free marketing. It's an honor. And that's happened a couple times for me. So that's been
even really better when they like it. It's like, I get it.
Absolutely cool.
Well, that's the great thing about like musicians. Cool. They're also usually pretty funny people in their like personal day-to-day lives, you know? And like, you know, I know this is from listening to Comedy Bang Bang when they have musicians on, like they're always talking about how like they kind of wish that they were more in the comedy field and stuff.
Because
it's like, it's weirdly, you know, almost opposite like emotional kind of contexts, you know, but in the similar realm.
And on those two things, like a couple years ago, I realized that that's just, I mean, passion's a strong word, but like in terms of my main hobbies and what is comedy and music. And I didn't think, and I remember when I said that to people, I was like, not together. And ironically enough, I run a music comedy page. So it's nice to combine my two passions and and then like you take Fred Armisen, who literally has stand up about musicians and music.
I love Fred Armisen. Yeah.
I got to see him twice and meet him. He did come to Charlotte.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
So that he's an inspiration for sure. Like the Portlandia skits. But yeah, just a quick intro for the listeners for the Instagram.
Been doing
it for over 2 years. The idea started in 2020. I had ran an Instagram called Modern Wax of my record collection, which I was really proud of, like attaining 3,000 followers in 5 years. And I took all my pictures.
That's nothing.
I connected with people in the community and But then I reached a point right before COVID where it just kind of hit me. I was like, I never thought I'd get rid of these records or stop collecting. But boy, if I sold them, I'd have money. And I could use that money to not work and travel and upgrade stuff. So I slowly, using the Instagram, sold all 600. I bulk sold the last 100 to some local record stores. Yeah, I shipped across the country into Canada. And I didn't get a net total because I was so focused on shipping. But anyway... You know, once I was done with that, I, you know, that was my hobby. So I was reposting my stuff, other people's stuff. It wasn't very fulfilling. Transitioning from running a vinyl account, I had been making, you know, casual memes for, you know, there's Facebook groups I'm into. Now there's like two King Gizzard ones.
Oh, there's a lot of King Gizzard stuff out there now.
Sufjan Stevens or whoever. Oh, and I'd make memes for my friends. And every now and then I'd like put. Which is really fun. I don't do this enough because it's not as it's more on my laptop than my phone. But like, you know, adding music to different footage and making people dance to the same BPM of a different song.
Yeah,
I was doing that, and someone was like, "You should do this like as a concentration." And I was following other pages and was like, immediately worried about like copyright claims and just and like, oh, I work so hard on everything to be taken down. But eventually, I was like, no, maybe I should, and that'd be more fulfilling to as a creative outlet as a hobby. And then in 2020, eventually I was writing down names the same way I ended up on Modern Wax. I'm writing down names. A big inspiration was a page called Neutral Milk Airbnb, which is just a great name.
We love Neutral Milk.
That's a great name for a page. Yeah,
it is. And he was one of the page that inspired me. And also I reached out to him. He was very supportive in like the DMs. He's not as active anymore, but he's married. I'm happy for him.
Yeah.
And that's another cool thing is meeting in the community, just becoming friends with these people you'd never meet otherwise. And I one of my names I wrote down was Niche Music Memes because I was like, that's what I'm going to make. And I'm like, it's pretty boring, but also it's not taken. And when I realized it wasn't taken on Instagram, I happened to check the rest of the internet, which was completely not taken. So I claimed every possible social media. I claimed the website.
Yeah.
I claimed the username on everything I possibly could just in case I really want to expand. At the time, I thought I was going to... I'm going to post to all the social media. And that was just stupid. But Instagram is just what my comfort zone. Well, it's true. I guess for me is the stress of like repeat. Cause I used to do this. I mean, I social media manage for a job and it's just mundane. Mm-hmm. You're like, oh, this account gets this picture, this account. So I was like, I'm just going to focus on the Instagram. Uh-huh. And occasionally I'll put the TikTok or YouTube.
Yeah.
I've never personally been to Twitter much. And anyway, So I started the account and like Modern Wax, I was like, I'm gonna do a fresh start New Year's. So I did, like I claimed it back in fall 2020, 2021 New Year's, launched the page.
Yeah.
I was considering just, you know, starting with my 3,000 followers, changing the name Modern Wax. I was like, no, I want to completely start fresh and have that as my memoir, my collection.
Yeah.
And I went from 50 followers. And then my first year, I had like an average of 1,000 a month, which was just insane.
That's awesome. Dude, nice.
I owe Anthony Fantano a lot of credit for my growth because I was trying to just have him as a someone to acknowledge a meme or two I made of him. He followed me. He shared so many of my memes to his story, a couple to his feed.
That's the goal,
that's
man.
Just directly. Yeah, because his audience is basically who I'm trying to reach.
And I mean, he's
the internet's music. Yeah.
So found him for a while.
That he says.
and he's someone I've watched and been a fan of for like 10 years now. So him advocating for memes and stuff like that was really cool. So to get his attention was cool as a goal, but also him sharing stuff would get way more reach.
Yeah.
And then just I've kind of had a slow growth, but once I hit 10,000, I was so excited. Once I hit 20,000, I was like, after 20,000, I want to stop being so hung up on like, oh, I didn't get 1,000 a month, because it's like sales and commission. And you're like, it's just a number. Yeah. So I'm happy to be approaching 25 and I want to highlight other accounts under that number as like a landmark. But it's just a cool community thing where it's a creative outlet where I make I say on my bio, 99% of everything. Very few times I maybe do a reshare or a collaborative post, but I make everything. And it's just fun to have people get involved, whether they just like it or share it or DM me or comment. And the community has turned into this like really wholesome thing. So and it's connected me in cool ways. You invited me here and I was just really excited to do this. So
I mean,
thanks for having me
on. We only have a fraction of that. And like the community is just such a cool aspect of, especially music. Cause like music is like weirdly one of those things that like, there are, definitely it's like political sometimes, or there's like, some takes, but like it's largely something that people can come together on and you know,
yeah,
just discuss like favorite musical
especially
stylings.
Enthusiasts.
Yeah.
Especially not to be divisive, but I've realized this growing up is like, because I like music has become something I've like been known to be obsessed with since, of course, like everybody gets like late high school, but yeah. like still.
Yeah.
And the you know, and there's nothing wrong with people who aren't super into music. Like I'm not really into sports. It's fine.
Yeah.
But like the people that are,
yeah.
even though they might have different tastes, can combine on this. We're all really weird together.
Yeah.
Because we love music too much.
Yeah.
And we need other people, and where we feel more collective. Yeah. And it's like, oh, it's not just me. And the internet connects everyone in a mostly cool way. So,
well, you know, speaking of the internet connecting together weird musical stylings, you brought to us King Gizzards and the Lizard Wizards. In case you forgot, guys, Petrodragonic Apocalypse or Dawn of Eternal Night and Annihilation of Planet Earth and the Beginning of Eternal Damnation.
And I want that on a coffee mug.
Dude, right? That'd be great.
There you go.
So what's your short King Gizzard story? You know, what brought
there's
you
always a story
to King Gizzard?
Great question. It's transitions to the vinyl thing. I had several good friends of mine into them, as I want to say, as early as maybe Nonagon in 2016 2017, going, Johnny, you'd like this.
I feel like that's when the US got it really hard, the first wave.
And there started you know, started blowing up, and I'd heard him around. I'm not as an active seeker outer of music as I was when I was younger. And I just kept putting them off, and I don't know why, but, and also I, because I followed other vinyl accounts with Modern Wax, I was like, whoa, they have a lot of really cool vinyl. And I knew in the back of my head, if I got into this band, I'd be broke. So that was a weird excuse to not even, my friend gave me that same friend gave me a tricolor Polygon of Wonderland. And because I'm like a completionist, I didn't even listen to it because it's not their first album. And it wasn't until, I guess, there's a freedom of like, oh, I'm not collecting. I'm actually going to deep dive them. And that was 2020 and 2021.
Oh,
and by the
shit,
time I think I did two listen, I was delivering pizza still. So I was able to listen to stuff right when I finished. I want to say my second listen through, Butterfly dropped, and Butterfly might be my favorite. Like, it's just such a serotonin. It's, and people have different opinions of it. I just fucking love it. It's just so beautiful, and I love the intricacies, but at the same time I'm on my, you know, fourth or fifth or sixth discography because there's so much. So at this point to be caught up feels very nice. To have seen them has been very nice. And to be a part of the community, and they're so memeable, going back to what I do, like I could just only make King Gizzard memes and be happy.
And there's so much material for that.
They give us so much material.
They're seriously good, but they don't take themselves too seriously. The community is
wonderful. We've done three anniversary specials. Just with their music.
Yeah, every anniversary special we cover a King Gizzard record. So we've covered, I think, I want to say like
seven or eight
at this point.
It was three anniversary. We've done a few with Kevin, right?
Yeah. Maybe this is the seventh or eighth. I don't know. But we've covered a lot of them. Honestly, a lot of them that connect to this album in particular, I think. This is like a spiritual sequel to a couple of them that we have covered on the podcast. So we I always say this is unofficially a King Gizzard podcast, as well as being a concept album podcast.
when you sent me the podcast, like, so I could look up what you've done and the spreadsheet,
the list,
I was, when you said concept albums, my head went immediately to Quadrophenia, and I'm like, ah, oh, they did it. I listened through a couple of them, and I saw the spreadsheet. I don't, podcasts are something that I really should be listening to more of, but I don't, but anyway,
takes time.
I had I saw the, and I'm post about this when it post, but the spreadsheet I saw, I was like, let me see what I got to choose from, and there were a handful of albums that I am very familiar with, but didn't feel personally like I was ready to deep dive them or talk about them. And then Brad had mentioned, like, suggest something, and I'm like, you haven't quite done Petro, and that's definitely a story. And again, thanks to my original introductory friend telling me this synopsis. So and it, you know, it's not my favorite concept album. It's not my favorite Gizzard album, but I love it. I've listened to it so many times. And speaking of like their genre hopping, and Gizzard love is, of course, the genre hopping and how you have metalheads getting into their, you know, their more psych rock or their acoustic stuff. And then vice versa, which is more like me. Like, I don't hate metal, not super into it.
Yeah.
So like, I remember Infest the Rat's Nest was like, whoa, this is kind of, but now I love it.
Yeah.
Calm down, guys. Yeah, yeah. And it's like, I don't know if y'all saw the clip. They played Planet B for Elmo. And he's like, he was a guest on an Australian show. And he's like, got to hold on to something. And it's a great, I just shared that clip on the page.
Oh, wow. I didn't even know that was a thing.
It was like an Australian record show. But anyway, yeah, I just chose this because I was like, there's a story there.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that's enough for it to be a concept. And I've, like you guys, re-listened to it. I've read along the lyrics, which is something I haven't done to an album in a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm ready to dive into this one.
So to set the stage a little bit for you guys, this one is the kind of spiritual successor to both, I would say, Infest the Rat's Nest and Murder of the Universe. Mm-hmm. If I were to pick two, both of them. You know what I mean? Because... you know, they both kind of allude to an event that like destroys the world as we know it, you know, and just ravages mm-hmm. it or whatever. And it's usually like, climate change kind of allegory about like the earth melting or something. And mm-hmm. in this one, it's like the dragon basically that like caused all of this destruction were given his story, I guess.
Yes.
We're given mm-hmm. the story of the just straight up apocalypse. Like
in a fun way.
Yeah. They've kind of gone around the apocalypse a lot, but this is like the like event.
Right.
Other than, I guess, the Murder of the Universe is like kind of the way after the apocalypse, I guess. You know what I mean?
True.
But yeah, I don't know if you're aware of the Gizverse stuff on YouTube. There's like, you know, the 9, I think, videos he did of the Gizverse. I rewatched a couple of those just to get myself in the right headspace. To start things off, though, they get to kind of explain the they're pretty straightforward as far as like, you know, what is causing all of this and why this is happening. Because they start with motor spirit. So here's a little bit of that. Yeah, motor spirit starting off real hard.
Can I say something real quick? And I'm not complaining. I didn't hear anything, so I was just.
Oh, you didn't hear anything?
No, it's fine. As long as it gets in the recording. What I did hear was a car speed by, and I'm like, the fucking irony. Like, it's like that's what I
motorsport.
I got to hear the most like alternate version, the most literal. Okay. Yeah,
we're gonna play it again. The zoom when the zoom restarted.
We want to make sure you shared.
Here is here's motorsport.
Now I have your computer sound. Yeah,
for the mm-hmm. guest. Yeah,
thank you. Okay, there it is.
You know, sometimes I just like to have the guests just stare at us while we're rocking out, you know, with no context.
I was rocking with you.
Yeah, yeah.
Very comfortable.
Yeah, yeah. We're all comfortable here. But yeah, Motor Spirit, he's like, mm-hmm. he's coming out the gate strong with this one, with Stu's classic, like, you know, growly metal voice he puts on every now and again. So this is one that has been, you know, highly anticipated, probably... maybe the most anticipated King Gizzard record, if I were to say, as far as like, you know, there was people talking about like, oh, it's going to be a metal album. It's going to be the successor to Infest the Rat's Nest, which is, I mm-hmm. think, probably before this one, the most critically acclaimed, I think, as far as like normal media is concerned. But yeah, this is definitely like you can hear already. It's the spiritual sequel to that sound. Just kind of setting the stage. He's just talking about all the awful things going on in the world, which he's so good at doing, Stu. You know, he's got a way with words.
I mean, it is the apocalypse.
It is the apocalypse, you know. Nothing to do.
You gotta have some bad shit going on.
Sit around and kind of say weird prophetic things, you know.
I was gonna be so professional and scholarly, and I had like a notebook to prepare for this, and all I've done is just deliberately copied and pasted summaries from Genius onto a like I didn't. None of these are my words.
But that's okay. They're
good talking points.
We use Genius a lot in this podcast. Yeah, it's our main.
I just
want
to point out it's cool that of course it's humanity's embracement of fossil fuel, even as much as like a cult would embrace something, it's that dependent, and it's a reflection of obviously where we've been in the industrial age, but also
right. yeah
apparently motor spirit, the term, is an old generic name for petrol, so I didn't know that, like spirit.
Oh.
Like yeah. So there you go.
Yeah that makes sense.
Very Mad Max.
Yeah right.
Oh, I had the same thought. I was like, someone needs to put footage of Mad Max just to this song.
Dude, yep. I mean, this. I was. There's a lot of footage that this music can be like put in front of. You know what I mean? Like, I was thinking. I mean, me and John were joking that like a lot of this could be like, it's Power Rangers-esque, I guess. Early
yes.
Power Rangers-esque.
No, I had this. I haven't put that into words, but especially there's guitar and Gia Monster where it's like, this sounds like Power Rangers.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah. And there's a few vocals a few times where they get a little Ron Wasserman-y. Mm-hmm. He's the guy that wrote that.
We've had him on.
Yeah, we had Ron
our
Wasserman.
Friend, Ron our friend, Wasserman,
Ron Wasserman. Our friend, Ron Wasserman, of the podcast.
A few times.
And, yeah, I think that he would really enjoy this because I feel like you, this is kind of almost like a whole generation later kind of picking up a little bit of that, like, what do they call it back then? Like, how was it, power metal at that point in the
it was
early
such
90s?
An intense, I mean, I was born in 92, so like my memories of the 90s are pretty condensed to a few moments, but like Power Rangers was strong.
Yeah,
and I had like the Megazord and like that that anthemic of
right
the
here
turbo.
Man
I want it from Turbo, yeah, like the red car and but that guitar didn't necessarily like make me get into metal as like a 7-year-old. I'm just saying, like,
yeah,
it didn't have to, but it helped you. It helped you like with like get into it later as an adult. Like
it took your hand and guided you across the sphere.
Yeah,
like,
yeah. Exactly.
I was into country as a kid, you know, and like,
oh wow,
like it really like. But later in life, I got into like metal and like. Mm-hmm. You know, like hard rock and like that. Yeah. And I know that's what was the bridge. Exactly.
Yeah, it has to
you know?
Be.
And as a sidebar, but also connecting it to this, like I used to have nightmares about like the horror of Power Rangers. And in retrospect, like when you watch it, like the essence of a nutshell, and I think they've kept this formula. Another fun fact where I'm from, years ago, the Silver Ranger, we went to high school together.
Oh wow,
that was kind of cool. Yeah, that's like,
dude,
our little
fantastic.
Hey. But anyway, yeah, like, and he was, and I was like, that's the guy, we were in a musical or something. But anyway,
dude, good for him.
Yeah, it was awesome.
Got
but what's crazy
work.
About Power Rangers is like the essence of Power Rangers, like when you dissect Dragon Ball or something.
Yeah,
it's like, okay, you got some 90s, you got some friends of, and they're in a Power Rangers. Nicki Minaj or someone like forms a monster out of clay, puts it in a giant Easy Bake, and then it's just a monster. They throw it in like a major city. There's definitely like just
so she's like
significant
doing
amount of death and ruin, and then the Power Rangers show up and they all have to go up to their size, also probably killing a bunch of people by stepping and like
of course,
and then they win and then but there's something, and like that's every episode, but it works, and that's why it's such a wild concept, and they're still doing it. So
yeah. The 30th anniversary, we were we had him on, Ron Wasserman on for that,
so
to
cool.
celebrate. And honestly, if you were a Power Rangers kid, it brings a few tears to your eyes watching the 30th anniversary thing.
So I'll have to look that up.
Yeah, it's fun.
And the town that Power Rangers took place in, best construction workers ever, because that town looks immaculate every time.
Oh yeah,
that's a very good point, Dave.
That's the thing of watching it as an adult.
Yeah, think about
like,
the workers.
Good on you guys.
Yeah.
Oh, very busy all the time.
Where's
always
Bob
about
the Builder
the abandoned,
when you need him?
It's always about the abandoned building system.
But one thing I wanted to mention is in this album, this one gets very biblical. Like like as in like more references specifically to like, I think the book of Isaiah and Revelation. Because we have you know, a seraph of Isaiah's light, a seraph, which it means burning one, in Christian anthology and angelology. That they could have been
it's a thing.
That could have been a better word. Angelology. Yeah, you can study it. Anyway. But it's the passage, I guess, is the throne. Hold on.
You're on Motor Spirit?
Yes. I'm trying to see if they actually have the passage listed. Well, Isaiah 6:1-8, if you want to look it up, break out your old Bible, guys. You can check it out.
Yeah.
There's this part.
It's interesting that he's doing that. He's bringing up biblical terms, but also in the narrative of the lyrics, he's quite literally mentioning Christians and agnostics, like, and they're both like in the same, like,
same boat. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what I love about it. Like, I like that he's, Stu is like just so well read and everything that he can
he's a nerd.
He can use mythologies from all over the place and use them effectively better than some of the people that like practice the, you know, the things.
Exactly.
And, and we need this message right now. Like, we really do need this message. So it could not be more like biblical in that sense, you know?
Sure. Yeah.
There's a lot of random references to that, like just kind of setting the stage, like to let you know this is, I mean, it says, you know, apocalypse is in the title of the album.
It's so, just scorched earth at this point.
Oh, not yet.
Well,
we'll get there, but yeah.
We're building.
Yeah.
Like, I didn't realize there's foreshadowing in the first song.
Right.
Mm-hmm. At least a little bit. I mean, about what's going to happen next. It is mentioned towards the end. Yeah.
The last several verses like start to mention like, you know, the witches, the fire raging with wild intent, to destroy all they present, you know? So this is, I guess, like I think the Motor Spirit like knows what is about to come. I see this as like him kind of foreshadowing to us, the audience, like, yo, I'm about to wreck this shit. So speaking of that, we're going to get to the next track, Supercell, where, you know, we start to get to, you know, this is probably these couple of tracks are the most like, I guess, down to earth in the sense that they're less fantastical and more like things we're dealing with a little bit right now sometimes.
Yeah. In the moment.
Yeah. So here's Supercell, and it's about a giant freaking storm. Yeah, and again, I think that was one of those lines where he was talking about, what was it? Murder everybody, cares not of theology, good Christians pummeled anon, agnostics, Armageddon. Yeah.
So some feel-good lyrics.
Yeah, it's a good time.
This is a feel-good record of the year. Yeah.
Upbeat.
Speaking of upbeat and I think y'all definitely going over this before, this just all praise to Cavs. Maybe even if it's like Trent getting, I'm not like, I dropped out of a music minor when I didn't, I wasn't have to do it, but like,
I don't
know how to be like, oh, there's this time of stage. I just know it's interesting and it's captivating to someone like me that just eats that type of stuff up. And that's like just Gizzard in general. I love it. It's just like, I don't even know what this is, but I'm in love with it. Yeah.
Well, you know, that's okay though, because I found a Reddit page got all of the time signatures laid out. I showed you the dragon one, but this is so Motor Spirit was mostly in either 5/4 or 10/4 or possibly 11/8. At 22, it's 4/4 until 45. And then Supercell, what you just heard, is I think 6/8. Or slow 4/4, and the verses are in 5/4, and then There's some 1116 somewhere in there.
Between the second and third course.
Yeah. I don't know what any of this means, guys. I'm going to be honest. But I remember...
It's fun to like count. Like that's all it is just knowing what to count.
Yeah, I was reading about it, like how, you know, drummers do, you know, count all of those things. And like, you know, I think I need to watch a couple of YouTube videos or something to really fully wrap my mind around it. But like, I don't understand how you make your brain like do that, you know,
like I drum, but I can't fathom any of that.
Yeah.
Like, it's just, I don't like, oh, I'm going to drum along to, no, I would, no. No, it's not going to happen.
No, no, not this. Well, and Cavs, like, he wasn't, you know, he didn't start out King Gizzard this good. You know what I mean? He's been really putting the time in and the effort in, like, you know, especially after losing, you know, a second drummer.
And it's coming. He's coming to his own.
Yeah. Like because, you know, he's a big Tool fan. You can hear that throughout the album.
Oh, yeah.
I think, like, really, this is, of all the albums, this is his album. To me, you know.
Oh yeah.
Because like just all the pictures you see of him like recording it, he's just got such a beaming smile the entire time, like a kid in a candy shop. Like,
yeah,
he's like, I can finally do it, guys. Like, he's so excited. So what's up?
I was just gonna say, didn't mean to interrupt. I was just saying another thing is, like, I'm not a lyrics first kind of guy unless something really jumps out at me. So this was cool to read them and go, and there's Wizard of Oz references because there's a tornado. So I'd love that.
Yeah. There's so many there's so much being said. It's almost like trying to follow like a rap song because of how many verses there are and how much.
Especially Ambrose. There's Ambrose verses in one of these songs where I was like, how is he doing that? Like, that's insane, impressive like cadence, and he's doing it.
Oh my goodness. This is maybe my favorite Ambrose. I love Ambrose in Murlocs. Like, don't get me wrong. That's my, you know, some of the best shit. But like, man, he really brings something to this album. Like,
yeah.
But yeah, here's a few references. Just, you know, he has a hill of gash flooding with flame, or spark from dying trees. The sky bleeds, the dragon feeds, the messiah on their knees, Jupiter laughs, immortal supercell. That's a reference to, like, you know, the red spot, of course, in Jupiter, the big storm. That's like,
what a concept.
So many of our planets in size. So one of the things I want to connect this to the other albums, though, as far as concepts go, is this album, I think, takes place, like, my headcanon for this takes place during Infest the Rat's Nest.
Okay.
So, like, basically the rich people have gone off to Mars and they do their whole thing, and then they die from the disease that happens out there, and then the Venusian 1 and Venusian 2 thing happens where they're trying to, you know, get to another planet, and meanwhile they're talking about Earth kind of mostly in like past tense in Infest the Rat's Nest, and like I think that this is what's happening, like that's what, like, what's happening meanwhile on Earth, this stuff is going on, is what I think is going on.
Same timeline.
Okay. Yeah. Like as closely related as two albums can be, I think, as far as they, because they don't usually connect them this closely, but I think they're definitely like, you know, brother sister albums, you know?
I mean, it's the notes I have is that at this point in the story where we are is that survivors watch helpless from the International Space Station. So that's, I guess, an interesting theory.
Yeah, they're drawing attention to it, I think. And I don't know if you watch the music videos, but there's, you know, the space station, the dragon goes up and like crashes it in one of the parts. It's fucking dope. I can't wait to talk about those music videos. I love those music videos. So there's a lot of horrible stuff going on. This one gave me some Venusian 1 vibes a little bit. I feel like you can hear, there's like a few times I think you hear the licks from some of the Infest the Rat's Nest songs, but like, I couldn't tell you exactly where they were. But this next track we got for you guys is when we have the supercell, which is already, you know, blowing away cities like leaves, as they say in the song. And then they converge into like just, you know, a bunch of like a bunch of supercells, pretty much. So
El Nino.
Think about like a thousand El Ninos.
All other storms must bow.
We must be one, become one.
I am El Nino. That's Spanish for the Nino.
There you go.
Yeah. All right. Well, yeah, this is Converge.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Oh, dude, yeah. Those vocals are totally great for putty kicking ass.
Dude, right? I'm telling you, like that is little
when
section
the Rangers
right there
are all flipping.
Yeah.
And they're doing their shit.
Yeah.
And they're just like punching them Z's where I like, you know.
Yeah, man. Like that's the first time I heard this track. That is where my mind went to. Because I mean, we've had Ron Wasserman on recently. So of course it's like on my mind. So I'm like, oh my God. This is like a Ron Wasserman part.
Our
holy
friend,
shit.
Our friend.
That's right.
Friend of the show, Ron Wasserman. We hang out all the time.
Right. BFFs.
Yeah, like it's just so like, it's, I don't know if it's intentional at all. You know, like there's no way to know like what their, you know, understanding of any Power Rangers is. But like, I think it'd be so cool if they were kind of trying to get that sound because if that was the case, they got it.
Yeah.
You know, it's exactly what you want in power metal from that time period.
Mm-hmm.
But
power metal, Power Rangers.
Power, exactly. I mean, you know, that's what we talked about, man.
Yeah. Power Man 5000.
Power Man 5000. Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Power cords. Exactly. See?
Power
see?
Cords. It's all connected.
Mm-hmm.
We're getting it, guys. But yeah, Converge. Like, this is where you start to hear Ambrose. Ambrose comes in a little bit. Him and Stu start, you know, going back and forth like they do, but he's not bringing his like his metal voice yet. He's
right.
he's just you know doing regular Ambrose, and then the ISS station, like you mentioned, they're watching from ungodly high, just watching the Earth just be fucking torn apart,
yep.
You know,
and that's luxury.
That's something I gotta say. Like, it's what's interesting is like the first like four or five tracks are like, you know, they have nothing to do with the actual like fire apocalypse or whatever. It's just what the humans have brought to the table, you know,
right
up to this point.
It's their doing.
Yeah, it's not right. Until witchcraft that it kind of takes like the supernatural element,
right?
You know. Mm-hmm. All of this crazy stuff is our, you know.
Great job, guys.
Great job. Thanks, Obama. You know what I mean?
Right.
But yeah, this is I like the imagery here though for how they talk about the tornadoes. Hungry, crawling, fat gray rat snake seems faster than the speed of light. Snail trail through the green glade. Just like I think in this track. Well, some people were like thinking that like specifically it's like destroying the like plains of like the U.S. in this song. Who knows?
Point.
Who knows? but yeah, just I feel like this and the last track kind of, you know, are part of a similar story. They're kind of, you know, a continuation of events. And then we get to track number four, which is where it starts to get a little weird. Here's witchcraft.
In the fields, wild, green and gold, where the summer's breeze was bold, the supercell rages and cradles, swirling vortex, a bubble boiled witchcraft. Slow upon one sable woe, when the moon does wane and die, a ragged coven, curtain fiends performing incantations now, witchcraft.
I fucking love that intro. Like, he's just such a good. He's so good at telling these like tales. You know, I was just listening to Murder of the Universe again, and it's a lot of this kind of stuff. You know, I honestly think Stu should almost like if he has to get away from music, he should definitely be a science fiction or short story writer or something.
Yeah.
Like, I want his science fiction book, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. But he puts it into this, you know what I mean? He throws everything into King
Gizzard. We'll
take it. And I'll definitely take it.
Yeah. I wanted to mention just a personal favorite musical moment is the bridge with, again, I don't know how to, I'm not an actual connoisseur in terms of like, oh, they're doing this double time thing. But there's this, when he says fire flickered and danced, there's this, they're like, I want it to repeat, but it's like, that's why it's good is because I wait for it. But the rhythm changes with the guitar strumming. And it's like, I don't want to say double time, but whatever they're doing, like I said, I don't know what it is, but I love it. So, and it's so gritty. And you're just like, oh, shit. And you're just, and it makes me get into it even more. And it happens at the bridge.
So they're saying that this is, what was it? 35:16 for the verse. Whatever
it,
that means, I don't even know.
Like
what that
I don't
means.
Even. It says insane,
and they says in parentheses basically 10+8+8+9.
Yeah,
and then
that's exhausting.
And then for the bridge 7, 8, and 5, 4, it switches between I think throughout the bridge.
That makes sense. That's more congestible for me because I brought up Sufjan earlier, and he's kind of one of the first artists where it's like, ooh, he's doing something that's not 4/4. Ooh, he's switching between two.
Oh yeah, he does.
But a bit more followable than Gizzard.
This is unfollowable for a casual music listener. That's the one thing I'll say that Infest the Rat's Nest has on this album is right. Like this one, I feel like you can't show it to all of your metal friends and have them appreciate it. A lot of them will, but this is like this
I
is
would
little,
hope so.
It's a little more proggy. I don't know. It's Rat's Nest is like so like classic
more
rock,
thrash, and,
you know.
Yeah. Thrash and speed metal stuff.
Yeah. Whereas this is a little more Gizzard than that one, I think.
And again, this isn't coming from someone, like I said, who's super into metal, can talk a lot about metal. Like one of my favorite metal bands is New Metal because it's System and they're just fun. But getting into an Infest and this album with my music knowledge that I have.
Yeah.
And overhearing a friend of a friend is like in the metal community. And apparently, and this is not the case on all metalheads, but apparently, and this is just going to be what's going to happen is people will hear this or just disregard it. Like, oh, that's not metal. They're not a metal band. Yes, it is.
Yeah.
Like, yes, it is. They're not even like, they didn't half-ass either album. They nailed it.
That is, that kind of stuff is just some gatekeeping bullshit.
It's,
you know,
it's so stupid.
It's so
annoying. Is more enjoyable than like, classic metal that I've heard, so I don't know. That's for
fucking
me,
fanboys.
Yeah. Like there's, it's bad,
and that's like I said. What I like about the Giz community is that generally you have those wholesome, and like whoever, like and again, I'm trying to not sound gatekeepy, ironically, right. But just like this is like if you're into metal and you're like and you like music, like you're gonna like. I feel like you have to. This is one of those things people are actively trying. To not like,
it's some things like, you know, some people like are just the kind of people where it gets a certain level of popularity and they're like, no,
such a sad way to live life.
Yeah. Especially when that's not usually something that's in their control, you know?
Right.
But
if y'all want to have a podcast about the Beatles, let me know. I'll talk about them.
Oh yeah, I could talk about the Beatles.
Speaking
for a while,
of metal, that's why I brought up the Beatles. Is when you think of metal,
you know, they were the Helter Skelter. Am I right?
Helter Skelter.
I still say Paul is like part of the original reason, like why screaming is a thing.
Well, I mean, I think it's a little bit for sure. But
if you listen to, there's a specific take of Helter Skelter that was released on the anniversary edition, and it's raw. Like he's screaming more. Ringo's playing heavier. Oh. That's where the blisters. And like and Paul's intent was quite literally, let's make obnoxious, like someone put that I Can See for Miles by The Who, which is a great song, but someone wrote that was really like a lot, and Paul's like, I'll give you a lot, and that's why that song exists, and I think that's so cool.
Oh, that's badass.
Mm-hmm.
So let's get into a little segment though before we get into another track. We're like halfway through the album, and we haven't done one of these in a while. We're going to do a little bit of what is Dave
drinking?
Brad. Huh? What? Oh, no. Do you not have your beers? But here's what is Dave drinking? What is Dave drinking? Yeah, yeah, yeah. So
I've never heard that. That was great.
So was a drinking intro, of
still
course.
The best intro.
we're just going to go around the horn and find out what everyone has been sipping on tonight.
I'm drinking some Steel Reserve tonight. Mm-hmm. I'm not drinking much these days, but I've been working a lot and got the old permission from the girlfriend to have a couple when I need to. And hey, I'm here tonight, and I'm having a little release tonight. So
yeah. Good for you.
Cheers to
enjoy.
The
enjoy.
Cheers
to the let go. You know.
Yeah. And then what about you, Dave? What have you been what are you sipping on tonight?
I feel like I failed because I haven't been bringing a lot of stuff to share. Past around like being kind of stuck in that routine. Like banquet, just relax and not worry about it.
Yeah. But, well, I've been feeling bad about not doing it, so I'm like, we should do one, you know?
Just something simple, just Stephen Point Brewery, the Point Lager.
Yeah.
It's
got a festive
It's just
festive
fantastic.
Can.
It's just the best basic lager, nothing crazy, but it's...
Yeah.
It's not macro, but it's still, it's just a solid kind of craft brew.
Yeah. It's always you never pass
can't
it up
wrong.
if it's one, the only option. It's like hell yeah, let's do it. And then I'll just say mine then. Coors Banquet, of course. We still had a couple in the fridge, and I had a little bit of Frank's apple pie recently, and that was still pretty strong because it's from last January or something. Just been sitting in my fridge. I had a few shots of it. It was like mostly cinnamon. Packed a punch. Yeah. but we got Frank coming on the YouTube very soon at some point here. Our guest. What about you, Johnny? What are you sipping on tonight?
I got 2 quarts of Walmart brand apple juice, 100%.
Hell yeah!
Picked it up. Like my cart didn't even stop. I just grabbed it reflexively.
Yeah,
apple juice was like a comfort thing for me. I remember it was like a nice little wholesome. Like I'd wake up in the middle of the night, my mom would walk me to the kitchen. We drink apple juice. Like I don't know why I like it so much. And ironically enough, apple cider was the first alcohol I tried because it was Johnny Appleseed. Yeah. My name's Johnny, and I'm like, that's it.
Yep.
Didn't like it.
Okay. Yeah.
Actually, I was tempted to. I have a can of strawberry banana Jumix.
Yeah.
Which is also from Walmart, 68 cents. But I was like, I don't want to spill it.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
We're going with apple juice.
Nice. Yeah. The classic. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. That's what we've been drinking tonight, everybody.
There you go.
Woo. All right, moving right along, we have the next half of the album where shit really hits the fan.
I want to respectfully interrupt. We have to mention a crucial plot point.
I was about to say, there is a very crucial plot point that happens in witchcraft.
after the bridge I was fanboying about, which is quite literally a cat named Beowulf.
Yeah. Yep.
Which, of course, a cat disrupts something.
Are you playing Diablo at all? Anyone here?
Me? No. It's not a genre for me. I grew up
there's
my friends
like,
playing.
There's a wolf named, or there's like a wolf. Of course, named Beowulf. That's like a main part of that
game. I think
I had to
read that in high school or middle school or high
school.
Yeah. The actual story of Beowulf. Yep. But
yeah. So, a lot of people, you know, it's a popular story, you know.
Mm, yeah.
Beowulf, what does he do?
While the witches are trying to conjure up some kind of stop to the storm,
they're doing their thing.
The cat quite literally distracts them, and their focus or their magic goes towards a small lizard.
Yeah.
If I'm not mistaken, a small lizard.
Yeah. Yeah.
Who quickly evolves to a Gia monster.
Yes.
Which is somewhat significant about what's about to happen.
Yeah. 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 He starts off just as a Gila monster, but as you'll see in the track titles, that he doesn't stay a Gila monster for long.
No.
Yeah. But yeah, here is Gila Monster, their first single for the album. Here is Gila Monster.
Gila!
Ambrose goes so fucking hard in that song.
I love in the video you see his like teeth, like you hear the way he's doing his voice, and it's this like kitschy, like he's not smiling, he's like grimacing,
yeah,
through it, and that's getting that back of the voice thing, and it's so fun. He's such a fun guy. Yeah.
Well, and like so okay, in the video, he's like doing the like, you know, looking forward and looking like, you know, trying to look like gross and mean and, you know,
menacing.
Evil. The Stanley Kubrick stare, as people were pointing out. Wait, was that you? Was that from your page?
No, I've made Stanley. I made Stanley memes.
Yeah, yeah.
But I haven't put two and two together of that yet.
Yeah, yeah. But so he's doing that. I think someone on the subreddit made that joke. But like,
oh sure, yeah.
Yeah. So he's being the, you know, the kind of evil, I guess, like. He's like one of the witches, but like also he's against the other witches because he's like speaking from the perspective of the Gila monster, and he wants to eat them and kill them. But yeah, so he's doing that like weird, like evil version of himself. And then if you saw the music video for Queen Pinky from Murlocs, that dropped like, I think within the same week. And he does a very similar type of character in that music video.
Huh.
So it's like you see like Ambi playing more and more with his like his persona and like his stage presence and like he's like, that's another thing, you can see his growth, like you see Cav's growth through the band, you can kind of see him come into his own.
Yeah, this is the music video you play for us.
Yeah, like, yeah,
with
yeah.
With the dark robes,
the horse scalping and shit. And
Gila!
Everyone's like, Gila!
Yeah. My favorite moment, and it happens, it shows, it might have been they literally just show the clip twice. Cavs is like, he's like, I don't know the motion of this is, but his lips quivering, and it's the funniest shit. He's just like, in the, that's oh, yeah. my favorite part of the video. Like,
he's doing, yeah, he does the, yeah, he's got like, he can like move, he's got like more stretchiness to his lips than the other guys, it seems. Yeah,
that's just my, and the random animals, or the wolves, whatever, yeah, and like the aesthetic of that whole thing was, they like had a lot of fun, as always.
Well, yeah, and I like that, you know, it's, you can tell that it's like, you know, some AI generated backgrounds and some CG stuff they're doing,
sure,
like, especially in the next, you know, music video, you can really see that. You know, I love that they're, you know, they've always embraced like classic styles, and even if it is, doesn't look like, you know, like Marvel 21st century like CGI or something.
Yeah,
that's not the point, you know.
No.
They're telling a story and stuff. I gotta bring attention to this, the bridge though, which we were talking about, that line. He's just talking about how badass he is, basically. Like a bunch of different ways. Like
he's eating the witches. Like they summoned him, and he's eating them.
Yeah,
like that's crazy.
Yeah.
Just every one of them.
That's just nuts.
Which I think where he gains his power to become a dragon, I think probably.
Yeah.
But I love this line. Compared to me, a pulsar is a lighter flame. Compared to mine, their Wicca is a mere child's game. Like. That's just a fucking metal line.
Yeah.
Compared to me, the pulsar is a lighter flame. Like, fuck, man. I don't know. That one got me when I first heard it. I was like, what did you just say?
Man, it's a whole metal album. So
this is the kind of stuff that makes me want a rap album, though. You know what I mean? Like, I want them to apply this level of, like, you know, lyrical, like, attention to a full rap album, you know?
Not just those two songs off. Yeah. Omnium.
Yeah, apparently they did like I think six or seven of them, but like they ended up just releasing the two because they didn't feel like it was, the others were up to snuff. But hey, I am all for the King Gizzard Beastie Boys style album.
Yeah,
anytime. Yeah. But yeah, so the Gila monster just eats everyone.
Yeah,
he kills them all. And I will say, okay, so. I don't know if you've been to the King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard Circle Jerk subreddit, but one of the, well, then you know the thing that it says at the top, King Gizzard and Lizard Wizard is the Wiggles for adults. And And I've always, like, you know, secretly resented that sentiment, you know, of course. But as much as I love this song, this one makes me feel that sentiment the most.
Yeah, that,
The Gila. Like, I was like, okay, yeah, I guess sometimes it is the Wiggles for adults, but I'm okay with this.
Well, this is different. This is very hardcore.
Yeah, yeah.
Even with the Gila. Gila!
But it's also just such a, the subreddit just lit up with this when this music video dropped. Mm-hmm. Everyone's just like, Gila! Oh, I'm Gila! Sure. Like,
so I did the listen through earlier when I was cooking. It was hard to pay attention to the lyrics a lot, but just every track, like track two, it reminded me of like it's sort of like a like 80s, 90s, sort of like metal. I couldn't think of a band, and like four, maybe something more like British metal. But this one reminded me of like Iron Maiden because it had the very gallopy guitar, like dun 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 dun, like this pounding, like it's so like every track, I'm like, this is great. I'm just like sitting there, just like prepping, like I'm just enjoying the track after track after track, and
yeah, it's very like re-listenable too, you know, like it's just,
and they all have like a different like sound and theme slightly, so it doesn't feel like it's the same thing droning on, but like it's very creative, like just every track is
I think that Infest the Rat's Nest, actually, like that's probably my one complaint of that album, is that there's a few times where it's like, you know, they're kind of getting into the same stuff they've already covered musically in the album, which, you know, thematically works, whatever, but like, you know, there's a few times where I'm like, I've heard this riff already in this album though. But yeah, they do, like, they're really like giving it their all you know, to make the best metal album that they think that they can right now, you know. As far as the time signatures,
I'm on the subreddit now.
Oh yeah,
yeah. It's King Gizzard and Lizard Wizard is like the Wiggles for stoned adults. If that
for
helps,
stoned adults.
If that helps the illusion,
that does.
Now everything makes sense. There you go.
Yeah. That makes sense. And you know, I don't disagree all the time, you know. But I it's still my favorite band. But yeah, most of the song, this song is in 6/8 or 4/4 or slow 4/4 until 3:37, where it goes into 11/8 until the end. Oh, and that's when Joey's on top of the mountain, meteorologist, Joey Walker.
Just rocking it out.
Isn't that like, I'm pretty sure that was, cause I was keeping up, I had been keeping up with them at that point. That was kind of a reveal. They got the guitar back, wasn't it? Like there was the guitar,
that's true.
They're broken.
Yeah.
I think it was broken and everybody was like, oh no. And then Joey has it. It's like, the guitar's back.
Yeah.
That was like the reveal.
What's it called? The Something Explorer, it's called. Cause it is an Explorer guitar, but there's like a name they refer to it as, but yeah. Mm-hmm. I knew it was back just cause I follow, you know, the subreddit and I saw that they had fixed it, but yeah, that was such a triumphant moment though for the fan base. They were like, yes, the guitar is alive. Mm-hmm. Cause yeah, we were all very sad when they lost those, their metal guitars. And I just love that they did that. I love that they even did that for like a guitar. Like this guitar has lore and the fans want it back. we're gonna deliver, you know. But yeah, so the Gila monster grows up very quickly into a dragon, and that's what we're gonna hear now. I love this album so much. I just love that Joey like learned how to do Mongolian throat singing so fucking well for this band.
Right.
Like he did a little bit in Infest the Rat's Nest, and this one he's just like, guys,
move over, I
cracked it. I fucking, and like, man, it's just like this deep, like crazy, like Latin chants and shit.
Then like, he just like does it to metal music.
Yeah,
just
I'm like crazy. I'm translating them right now.
Yeah. They
like
have
who brings up Latin anymore? Like that, it's so badass.
Fucking Joey Walker, bro.
I don't know about y'all, but like when I was going to talk about this is probably my favorite. I mean, it's just the most grandiose song. And when Gia came out, I remember I watched that music video and listened to it several times. Like, oh, it's so badass, it's so fun to be like a on track Gizzard fan and a cool new metal album. Yeah, I'm into it. And then I watched the Dragon music video. I think I got my Bluetooth connection to speakers by my pillow, and I was watching this thing, and I'm like, oh shit, this song kicks the other one's ass.
Yeah,
like,
right.
Which is thematic, because that's, and I realize that saying this now, just like, that's the point, is Gia evolves.
Yeah.
But this song, like, I couldn't believe the changes, the timing, I was just blown away by this. Every time I hear it, really, it's probably my favorite. It's just the strong. I think that's the point. It's the strongest song on the album.
Yeah, yeah. It's such, I think, so too.
That's the point. It's a beast of a song, which is the point.
Yeah, yeah. Well,
that
and
is
the
point.
The lyrics are freaking crazy. Like one of my favorite lyrics in this one is, hold on, let me find it.
What's stronger than a pulsar?
Yeah, right. What's what is stronger than a pulsar? I don't actually know.
This track.
I love this. Yeah. The eye dilates, the air gyrates, a gate in the sky, a portal to die, a shriek from space, a mangled yell, dragon descends, welcome to hell. That verse goes hard. Like, I just like the air gyrates, like, is one of the coolest, like, it's one of the coolest ways I've heard someone describe, like, you know, maybe like the shockwave that comes from like a bomb or something is what I think of when I hear that. Because you know, he's out there shooting basically, you know, nuclear bombs off at cities, just doing his dragon thing. But yeah, the air gyrates. It's such a like weirdly like sexual way to like describe like the earth being destroyed.
It's fucking the, like, yeah, it's, they're fucked up.
Yeah,
like,
yeah, literally. Yeah, yeah. It's so I don't know. There's the writing on this album is just so good, you know. The time signatures, right? So let's talk about time signatures.
It's a whole post.
Yeah, so I'm just gonna read the whole post. All right, guys.
Yeah,
because there's no other way to describe this. He says, this is by user maintain or man maytan pie three no maytan pie not three it's 3 months ago. Anyway, I could be wrong in some parts, but I think this is mostly correct. 17 bars of 11-8, 8 bars of 9-8, 48 bars of 7-8, 12 bars of 9-8, 4 bars of 11-8, 28 bars of 6-4, vocals in 5-4, 40 bars in 10-8, 36 bars in 7-8, 8 bars in 13-4. Then we got 8 bars of 4-4 for the normies out there. 8 bars of 13-4, 24 bars of 4-4. 3 bars of 13-4, 3 bars of 4-4, and then 33 more bars of 11-8. Even if I'm wrong, crazy. The time signature in this song is fucking insane. Like, bruh.
Yeah.
That's just crazy.
Bringing all this up reminds me of it was a Tom Dowd documentary talking about, like, the Allman Brothers were, like, when they're on stage, like, they'll start a song, and then they all instantly break off in different time signatures.
Oh, yeah.
And
yeah,
they're all just, they like, jamming, and then they slowly can just come back. The one, finish the song and start the next one, just goes on the same way. Like, they just all are just so intense, but like they're well enough to like keep each other like just at arm's length to keep, like, so the song doesn't go crazy.
Yeah.
And just like bring it right back in and then to stop it and do it all over again.
Man, I'm really gonna have to listen to those live albums, man.
Like, it's like really good.
I've always heard all those stories about them. I didn't know they fucked around with time signatures that much too. Because, like, I just don't, like, you just have to be such a
nerd,
talented musician in order to, like, even approach this kind of playing.
Oh, for sure. Like,
but, yeah, this is, you know, again, this is Cavs really, like, bringing it his all and showing people what he's capable of.
This is insane.
So, one of the best songs, I mean, definitely, I think, one of the best songs on the album, if not one of the best in their discography. Like, it's fucking good, and the music video is fantastic too.
That's so much fun.
It's such a ride.
Isn't it all black and white?
I think some of it. Like, oh wait, is it all black and white?
Let me skip through it. I love one. I mean, it's just they do a lot. Even Giga Monster, they do great stuff. The dragon, the dawn of eternal light is like the rhythmic motion of the dragon walking.
That part's great.
I want to say that that JJ Cool Juice, who does their album cover, like, he did that too. Like, he did The whole, and it's such a, I love, I mean, it's like watching it. It's like watching Edgar Wright or something. Like you're watching perfect syncopation to visual and audio.
I think it's Jason Galea is the guy that does
that. Yeah, that's his Instagram. I was like, I'm blanking out on his real name, but I know his Instagram name.
Yeah.
JJ Cool Juice. But yeah, I think Jason.
Oh yeah, that is his. Yeah, I'm seeing that. But yeah, I love, and he's had a growth throughout their journey too.
Oh,
you see his style change and grow. And I love the PS1 stew running away.
Yeah.
That's maybe one of my favorite parts.
It's black and white. There's a bit at the beginning where it's flame colored.
Yeah.
Like it's mono, but it looks like it's 75% black and white.
Yeah.
The rest of
okay.
it. So, and it still is so entertaining and engaging.
Yeah. I love how Ambi, I don't think, is playing anything. I don't think Ambi has a part in this song, but he's just like rocking the fuck out in the rest of the
they're all wearing, individual metal band shirts as an homage to Motorhead and,
well, and, who else? And the bass player is just dressed like Lemmy.
Yeah.
And I love, and again, I'd message you about this, but my favorite part is the very last section of the song. Stu rolls up in his motorcycle, and then poses and puts his hands in he's supposed to put his hands in his leather jacket pocket, and he just misses over and over again, and then it just goes to the next scene. And it's just like, oh, it's the most Stu thing I've ever seen.
Keep it perfect.
I just watched that clip, and I'm glad you said that, because I never noticed. I just was looking at his face looking badass, but yeah, he completely misses his.
I didn't notice it until like the third or fourth time I was watching it, and I was just like, wait, did he just totally miss? And they left it in, because the music video, other than that, is like, it's, you know, badass front to back, you know what I mean? Like, they're being pretty serious in this video. But yeah, I love that they left it in. I don't know if the editor noticed and left it in, or
intentionally.
Yeah,
that's what I like. Going back to they're just goofy. Like, that's what's great about liking them is I remember in with my friends I got into music with in high school. I came over to my friend's house, and his dad was having a Dream Theater DVD playing, I walked in and I watched Dream Theater. And I'm going, they're so good, I don't like this. Like, they're so they're so tight that I can't enjoy this. So King Gizzard has this nice blend of they're extremely tight, but they're goofballs. And I love that about them.
Yeah. Especially if you follow any of their Instagrams, it's such a fun, fun stories and everything. Also, you get a hint at what's coming up next, you know?
Mm-hmm. Gotta stalk the boys.
I think there is a big synth album coming, because I remember a while back there was a bunch of, they were
all signs are pointing
all
to the next album
creating synths. So
I ordered the Butterfly 3000 Blu-ray of music videos, which I'm waiting on my ears to officially clear out from being clogged to watch. But now I'm part of the mailing list. And the last thing I saw or something like that was saying the album, some message from Stu saying the album is done and we're excited for you to hear it. But yeah, in terms of hints and all these theories, it's going to be a yin and yang to this one. It's going to be synthy, and I'm all for that. So.
Oh yeah, I'm really excited. If it's anything Butterfly 3000,
that's my shit. Fucking go. I love Butterfly.
That's absolutely. I think the Butterfly's got the best music videos of all the.
I'm excited to watch.
Partially because it happened during the pandemic, but I think because of that, we got a lot of really cool animated stuff, music videos wise.
Yeah.
This next track we got for you though. The dragon's done a lot of damage, but he's not going to be happy until every living thing is dead on this planet. So,
you have to have goals.
You gotta have goals. You know, that's exactly right, Dave.
That's the moral of the story. Is you gotta have goals.
You gotta have goals.
If you're gonna do it, don't half-ass.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. This dragon did not half-ass anything.
He had a good guidance counselor.
Yeah. Yeah. And then he ate him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Here's a flamethrower.
It's like a way to gauge people. Play that song for them, and if their head doesn't bob, they're probably not that cool.
Yeah. So, you should stop hanging out with them.
It's so cool.
Cut ties.
Yeah. They're probably pretty boring.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
Lame Lamersons.
Well, you gotta feel
lame
Lamersons. It,
Lame thrower. Yeah.
More like lame thrower, they say. And you never talk to them again.
And they're like, what the fuck's wrong with that guy? I'm like, gatekeep King Gizzard.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, I love that, you know, Dragon is like a really, you know, a 9 minute and some odd second song. And then Flamethrower, I think, is also somewhat like that. So they end really like with the long the heat jammy up. Songs. Yeah. Turn the heat up, if you will. Yeah. Yeah. This is, you know, probably the most, pointed, I think, Stu gets about like, you know, who's to blame, I think, on mm-hmm. the album. First he says, let's see, soul blackened by the dark arts, strike fear in mortal hearts, taketh to the sky with blazing darts, flame those foolish, lazy fucks. And then, in the other verse, where does he say it? Flamethrower, those complacent fucks is the other time he says
it. You can't unhear that when you're listening.
Bro. Yeah. Yeah.
The way he says it is so,
very poignant.
He's mad, you know.
Yeah,
you can tell Stu's
complacent
mad.
Fucks.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah,
and yeah, and it's like such a
he wants you to hear that.
I like that. You know, a lot of time he's kind of dancing around, like who exactly is responsible or whatever in these, because he's kind of keeping to the fantastical stuff. But like, he's like straight up like, hey, I'm talking about you complacent motherfuckers out there. Like we need to do something.
Stuff needs to change. Yeah.
I made a meme. I had stumbled upon an Instagram of Greta Thunberg holding a rectangle or holding a square that said something, a call to action, which is cool. But I'm like, that could be that looks like it'd be an album cover. And I definitely put this album cover in Fest the Rat Sniff. There were certain people who shared certain things of hers where I was like, did I do too good of a job photoshopping? I think people think this is real. I sneak watermarks in my memes, but I was like,
yes.
I think people think that. No, what it was is for irony, I made 10 of them.
Yeah.
And the last slide was a Greta Van Fleet album. And you can see people's public story shares, and I'm bored. So I always look at them, and then they're like, yo, no way. Greta's a great. I'm like, I hope this is irony because it's not. Because I'm like a sucker for the truth, and I'm not trying to spread, but I did a good job.
Unfortunately, it probably isn't. If I'm being honest with what I've known of the internet, like people definitely will believe something.
He's a big fan.
Just a glance, like that seems legit. That must be true.
I saw it on the internet.
I saw it on the internet. I'm going to pretend Photoshop doesn't exist.
That's the generational meme of give or take our ages of like our parents being like, don't reveal everything on the internet. Now we're telling them that.
We're like, seriously though, you shouldn't.
Well, the problem is you have to believe a lot of the stuff on the, you don't have to believe a lot of the stuff on the internet, but a lot of the stuff on the internet.
Yeah.
Is true now.
Like the earth is flat. Like, I got it. It's real.
And,
trust me. I watched a video. It's flat.
I did my own research.
I mean, remember that Eiffel 65 album we did? He said that he'd been to the edge. You know what I mean? So we know.
What more?
If we can't trust that guy.
If you can't trust Eiffel 65, what kind of world
who
are we living
can you
in?
Trust?
I've always something I've realized in like retrospect is I've been a buzzkill for the truth since like as long as I can remember. Like for instance, now like something now someone shows something like a funny video and I'm going, I'm sorry, that's not real. Why were they filming? Why were they filming? Yeah. Like, and right. I
that's
that
the first question.
And I can appreciate skits and like okay, they did a good job at that. But like we were talking about the 90s. I think in 99 or maybe 2000 we went to Universal Studios and there was a really amazing animatronic triceratops and it was like it piss and people were gathered around and I had to be like 8 or 9 and my older sisters and like and I'm such a buzzkill. Johnny, look, and I'm like, it's not real, they're extinct, it's a robot, why is it? And I was a kid. and I'm still like
Captain
Buzzkill. I'm that buzzkill where it's like that's not true.
There's no way that's real, right? Like, I can't.
So and nowadays with the internet is I had a coworker who he blew up on TikTok and it was like, he pranked his girlfriend. And he's like, yeah, those were all fake. And I'm like, that makes me sad. Like if you're going to do something, make it like, that's why I like prefer like script. I can't stand anything like reality, but that's on a tangent, but.
Dude, right? Anyway, oh my God, right?
I'm a genuine person, and like, if you're gonna do something fantasy,
well, it's just weird. It's just weird.
Obvious that it's not.
Yeah,
real.
It's the weird thing is that it's always like lately. The thing is, it's being presented like it's real, And then that's the problem, why they get clicks and shares, is because people think it's real. And like, that's, it seems predatory in a weird way. Like,
yeah, it's really dangerous, actually.
Yeah, yeah.
You got to be careful what you listen to.
Well, yeah, and it trains you to be.
That is true 100%.
Dumb? I don't know.
Yeah.
Maybe we're sounding old and out of touch. I don't know,
guys. Always train
email
you
us.
To be dumb.
Call us on the phone line, 1608 Hit Nerd.
Just got to be careful with what you listen to.
Tell us about your TikTok experience.
That's right. But
I just wanted to mention one more thing before I get to another. I have one more clip for this track, actually, because I wanted to show the later bit.
Because it's a big track.
Because there's some cool drums in the later bit. They do some references to other King Gizzard songs. Dragon Death Roll. They say Mayday, Mayday, calling ground control. The space station is in a dragon death roll, which is a reference to
Evil
Death Roll. Right. Thank you.
I completely cheated here with the genius, but that you can click it. Genius.
I should click these when I'm talking about
them. We're on the same website. Okay.
And then Gaia, set to self-destruct. You know, there's Gaia, the song Gaia, which is
one of my favorite Gizzard songs.
I think Gaia is part of this story and timeline.
Yeah.
He spews the motor spirit breath, torches the ISS, which is just kind of cool to think about. I don't have any like ill will of the ISS. I just think,
man, this dragon is
dragon's fucking cool.
Just destroying the Gizverse.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's kind of the point of the Gizverse in a lot of ways. It's just the destruction of everything.
The
inevitable. Mm. And like going back to like as a kind of wrap full circle, and we'll do the bonus track, is like the refrain is motor spirit. Mm-hmm. The fact that the beginning of the album and the translation to like reality and the allegory, whatever, is like humans depending on fossil fuels, goes right to supercell, which is like climate change directly being the cause of storms and which hurts humanity. And then it's just, I think the dragon is like an allegory of like inevitable climate change and all this stuff. A good feel good message for the fans. And
we just create witches and gila monsters and dragons.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. And then
there's nothing we can do.
Yeah. But listen, like after this, there's
fuck
plenty.
You, humans.
We still have Murder of the Universe to look forward to after this.
Oh, all right.
So don't worry. Here's a flamethrower though. The post, I call it post credits, cause it feels like it's after the story is kind of wrapping up.
The first half reminded me of like a early PlayStation 1 like RPG, like at the end, like, oh, the base is for you have to escape.
Yeah, it's like high energy, you gotta run.
There's urgency to it. Yeah.
All
right. Yeah. I just like this one that I included that clip just to really, really, really show Cav's shining. You know what I mean? Like he's in full tool mode, just fucking going at it.
But the good tool mode.
Yeah, good tool.
All right.
I feel like drums are mostly good in Tool. You know, I feel like if you separate the art from the drummer or something, I don't know what the phrase is. I think that, you know, I'm glad they include, like, they have this little kind of outro bit because it just kind of emphasizes, like, yes, this is Cav's album, you know?
All right.
And then we've talked about this already a little bit, and then we'll get to the last track. This is Dawn of Eternal Night. And so this
vinyl
is
vinyl exclusive.
This is the vinyl exclusive. It is on YouTube as of recording. I think they mostly left it on because, I mean, you know. Yeah,
they don't care. That's what's
sometimes
nice about
they do.
Really...
Like, well, there was that one
movie
that they put out that was only available for 48 hours.
I still haven't seen. Yeah, I haven't had a chance because there's. Yeah. But in terms of like, audio
I'll
recordings,
you.
I love
I'll message
how
you after they... the show.
What were you saying?
Oh, just like they promote bootlegging, and in terms of like, that's what I like about them is like, you don't have to necessarily worry, like, especially for someone who me, who's not collecting vinyl. Oh, that's nice. Cause that was one of the cool things is you'd have exclusive B-sides or tracks. And,
well, I think the only thing that they have ever actually cared about in that sense is that 48 hour movie I'm talking about, because people did try to upload like sections of that and they got taken down. It's like the only time I've ever seen King Gizzard do anything like that. But yeah, they did.
I mean, that's fair.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, you know, they were, I think they were supporting their like, you know, friends, like kind of a film company too. So they're trying to, yeah. you know, kind of boost their, you know, sales and things like that. And I'm sure they'll release it on DVD one day. But,
I'll buy it.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. There's merch all over.
I assume now you're going to read the entire poem.
Oh yeah. Yeah. So, we have everyone settle in. It should take me about, I mean, it took 15 minutes in the album, but it might take me a little bit longer. here is Dawn of Eternal Night.
I curled my tail around to lay my head upon it and relaxed. The old mansion quivered like a violin bow, and the screaming of the wind turned to a sweet song. As I lay in a fog of
I swear to God, this is just like Game of Thrones, like alive.
Yep. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know?
It's definitely like, yeah, very, very fantasy vibes, mm-hmm. like hardcore.
So many thoughts. One was it reminded me right away of like the, I think it was the early 2000s movie, Rain of Fire.
Oh, yeah.
My last roommate showed me that movie. Yeah.
That's right. Yeah. That is kind of like this
just like, you know, there's plot a little bit. Humanity, but they're only in like I think it takes place like in Europe around like Scotland, or like they have people just living in castles because it's like the one last thing that the dragon right. can't really destroy. So they're mm-hmm. living these like buildings.
Yeah. Yeah,
but they're still like throwing fire through yeah. the doors and just through the halls.
Yeah,
and,
yeah, yeah,
yeah, yeah. Most it's, definitely.
Yeah,
it's like if I remember it correctly, like it's like a, it's almost like Walking Dead, but instead of zombies, the threat yep. is See, like it's dragons, and you have to be prepared and like different
at all times.
I think like they all like there's like survival, and it's like shit's real because it's dragons yeah. and they're having to fend for themselves and they're human.
Well, it's like I was listening to this at work, you know, and like
yeah
I was really trying to pay attention because we didn't do this in the listen through, so like Brad yeah, like, yeah, yeah. like said that, so I was like really trying to like actually pay attention to this, and like I'm like it gets to the middle part and she's just like talking about like how like parts are changing and she's melting down, and then she's coming back to life, and she's coming back yeah. stronger, and
yeah,
and she's coming back as a dragon, you know, and like yeah. she makes that very clear,
yeah,
like,
yeah,
the whole thing,
yeah.
Know?
This is just crazy. The return of Leah Senior, mm-hmm. who's from did a lot of stuff in, you know, Murder of the Universe, right. and I think she's got a few lines in Polygon Dwanaland, but yeah, if anyone is the narrator of the Gizverse, it is her,
right?
You know,
yeah. They had her open at my show
in
Nashville.
Oh, that's cool as shit.
And everybody in the crowd's like, no, that's her.
That's her. It's fucking her.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah, and she's just trying to do her original songs. Like, oh, that's her from Murder. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. I'd freak out if I ever saw
it was cool.
Like a senior in public. Yeah. But like, you're like the muse goddess, whatever, in the Gizverse. I'm not sure exactly. But like, you tell the stories, you know?
Yeah.
I kind of wish every album ended like this, you know, like a little recap.
Blowback to, or just flashback to listen to like Liquid Swords, like last week, like it starts out with the young girl telling the tale of like the shogun, the warrior, like right away. Like it just reminded me of like the story. You're like, oh, what's next? All right. Well, it's kind of sucked into this.
And the audio, the soundscape they make for it is so good. Like it's like, it just like, I want a whole audiobook that's produced like that.
Part of it also sounds like Tom Waits. What's he building in there? Or just when he's like doing dialogue, just this weird like sounds in the background, like creaking and like
and
it's immersive.
They're throwing a few of their motifs in there, but like it's overall like a completely different vibe than the rest of the album.
Mm-hmm.
It's just it's like
metal.
I like that it's from the perspective of the Gila monster and like through the transformation, like you were saying. Like it's like once I heard this track finally on YouTube, I was like, oh, well, this is like the perfect way to the end of the album. I wish that it was on the normal one, but I totally, you know, I get why it's on the vinyl only. Cause you gotta have some stuff that's vinyl only, but
especially when it's King Lizard.
Yeah. King Lizard and the Gizzard.
Wizards.
King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard.
Snizzard.
Lizard and the Lizard.
My bad.
Lizard. But yeah, it's just such a cool way to. I mean, again, I would like it if they had.
It's a great way to end the
every album like this.
Story time
with Leah Senior.
Yeah,
I don't know why Leah Senior doesn't just have a bunch of audiobooks out there. I mean,
she's really good at it. Yeah,
she's amazing.
Very good.
I'd love to someday like do a deep dive and find out kind of their kind of story as friends or whatever. Like, did she just come to the studio, or like were they like friends before?
They're all Aussies, so there's
I wonder how far back they go, because she very seems cool. to be very important to the group, you know what I mean? Like, they seem to have a lot of respect for her. So yeah, that's Leah Senior doing the end of that, and that's the album. The Earth's gone. The Earth's destroyed. Everyone's dead.
There's just the dragon.
We fixed the gas problem.
That's true.
Everything's fine.
The Earth is fine.
It'll recover. You know, give a few hundred thousand. Yeah, it'll be fine.
Well, that's what you're supposed to do, anyways. You know.
Yeah. At some point in Infest the Rat's Nest, they lost a connection with the space station on Earth, unexplained until now.
Who needs a space station?
Who needs it?
Right.
Bunch of rich fucks anyway.
I like how he uses in the music video, he uses the space station like it looks like he's using it like a bomb. Like he rides it down. It's so cool. So anyway, we have one more segment we do on the podcast before we close out, and that is going around the horn and finding out what everyone has been listening to lately and what they have to plug. I'll start and go to John and then Dave, and then we'll end with Johnny, our guest. I have been listening to, first of all, the Fleetwood Mac live album for Rumors. Really, really good stuff. I've only listened to it one time so far, but I think it's from that time period, if I can guess from some of the things you're saying. I didn't really read into it.
I've listened to that.
It's really great. Myself as well. And then, you know, of course, Infest the Rat's Nest and all the King Gizzard I caught up on. And then, the Gizverse videos. I will recommend, if you like to think about how these albums are connected, there's the Gizverse videos where like a 9-part series, I think, where this guy really tries to connect it as best as he can and break it down. He hasn't put one out in like 2 years though. So I really hope he's like, you know, just taking time on the next one, because there's a lot more Gizverse stuff to talk about since a couple years ago. So I'll recommend that. I'll put a link in the description for you guys about that. And then John, what have you been listening to lately, and what do you got to plug?
I've actually been listening to a lot of Jim Croce live stuff, actually. Okay. Believe it or not. I've been listening to that at Wings with Jeremy, because I've been working a lot with him.
Nice.
And that's really cool. Otherwise, I've listened to the full album of the Boston album. Original, like the first album. Just a banger.
Boston.
Front to banger. And Carole King's Tapestry as well. Listening to a lot of that stuff. Not much to plug otherwise. The 30th anniversary of Power Rangers is coming out, like the 30th season. The Cosmic Fury, looking forward to that. That's coming out on that
10 episode thing.
10 episodes, gonna wrap up 30 years worth of storylines. Looks like they're actually trying to do a good job of justifying it all and honoring it, all of it. So very excited for that.
I'm pretty excited too, honestly. What about you, Dave? What have you been listening to lately?
So just bands in the last week have been Ramones, some Screeching Weasel, Suicide Machines, At the Drive-In, Beastie Boys, some early Atmosphere, and some Wu-Tang.
Yeah.
That's been this past week sort of listen through.
I forgot about the Suicide Machines.
It's
a good group. What about you then, Johnny from Niche Music Memes? What have you been listening to lately?
There's this band called King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard. I've been really diving into them.
I've never heard of them. Are they like the Beatles?
Only 25 albums. They're not very productive. That's what's funny is within the past months, I've actually been doing a complete, like, one of my, I think at this point, fourth, fifth, sixth discog dive. because there's just like you brought Murder of the Universe. I'm like, that might be one of my least in total listen. So I'm in the middle of I had a middle of a sickness, so I didn't want to listen to music with my ears being clogged. I think I'm on the out the end of that.
Oh yeah.
But
yeah.
For me, Sufjan Stevens was like my favorite artist for the past like my 20s, and for some reason I love him, but there's something about his most recent album from 2020 that just didn't click with me. But these new singles that have been out, which sometimes I like to just not listen to singles at all. With this one, I'm just doing just once. So I'm kind of in the middle there, but they're sounding a return to form. So I'm very excited for Javelin.
Oh, awesome.
I'm seeing, and another surprise from this year, Lil Yachty's Let's Start Here. I'm seeing him in a month, and I can't like, I was pretty neutral on him, but Let's Start Here, he went full psych rock, and it's really good. It's really good.
Wait, Lil Yachty, psych rock?
It's January. He dropped Let's Start Here. The album cover is an AI nightmare. It's an hour long album. And from the first song, you're like, what is this? And he recruited I'm telling y'all,
Okay.
Lil Yachty's last album is actually
like, I'm trying
90% psych rock.
I'm thinking about Lil Yachty, and it feels very like, I was like, what?
It surprised me. It surprised me too, but it surprised me with like, it might be my most listened to album of the year.
Well, he's got,
I just really like it.
Well, I enjoy him, you know, like whenever I see him on like his screen in his music videos, he's like having a great time, you know?
Yeah. And it's very much like, oh, he did acid and he likes Pink Floyd and Tame Impala, and it's just super.
Yeah, let's just do that.
Prevalent.
Let's just do one of
those.
And
I'm gonna see him in Charlotte.
That's very
cool.
And
also, a band called Squid. They're really cool.
Yeah.
They put out their second album, and they just have some wonderful energy and progressive whatever they're doing. I hope they come around these parts so I can see them.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Nice.
That's been it pretty much for me. Yeah.
And then where can we find you on the social media? So, obviously, you know, the niche music.
Every one of them, but the every one of them, but the Instagram is the only one I actually I try to post every morning. If not, I take Sundays off, just whatever. Mm-hmm. Instagram at NICHEMUSICMEME, like niche music memes. Check it out, and if it's not for you, no big deal. But yeah, it's like that's my hobby. Like I go to work at Best Buy, I come home, watch YouTube, play some video games, make memes, go to bed, repeat. So it's what I do, and I've met a lot of cool people. This, of course, has been a nice surprise.
I've had
small opportunities, but this was really a really wonderful experience, and I really appreciate you guys having me on.
Oh, thank you, man.
It means a lot.
Yeah.
And I can't wait to post about this, and hopefully we can get you guys some more viewers and stuff once I do.
Yeah, dude. Thank you for coming on, man. Like I really, really enjoy your stuff, and you not only do you make great memes about music, but you really definitely care about music. That's important when it comes to music. Thank you again for coming on. Thanks everyone for listening, and we'll see you all next week for another episode of the Album Concept Hour.
Later.
The Album Concept Hour is Brad LeBaron, Dave Gallagher, and John Aker. Special thanks to King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard for the theme music. Join the discussion on our Discord, tweet to us at albumconceptpod, or for everything else, go to linktree.com/FlyOverStatePark. See you on Site B.
This is FlyOver State Park. You are clear to land.